Knock, 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 knock. Are you ready? Are you ready? Yeah, someone's knocking at our door, that is for sure, saying, are we ready? And we say, well, we're getting ready, that's for sure. And the reason why I keep making these videos is to set an example for the kind of work ethic that everyone really needs to have. You have to work at it. You have to be determined. You have to keep your momentum going, and because it's rather elusive, what we are trying to accept. Our acceptance seems to be somewhat weak and fickle. We're quite fickle with our acceptance. We say, well, I'm almost, maybe in a, a little while, I'll accept that truth is true and nothing else is true. Meanwhile, we keep suffering. So welcome to the video. And a week of work is done. It's Friday, May 1st. Welcome to May. and it started out to, it's turning into be an incredibly tempestuous May. My entire life this time, since I've been here, has been nothing but strife. Social strife, racial strife, strife of every type in the United States and around the world. And to say that I'm tired of it is the vast understatement. And to say also that I'm tired of all of these talking heads weighing in, none of them have the answer. None of them really point out what's actually going on. And so that's why I say, well, I have to do it myself here. This planet is following a script, a blueprint, that has been long worked on and devised by what we call extraterrestrial civilizations. I call it the cosmic corporate culture, which is a consortium of different extraterrestrial civilizations and alliances, and it's like a corporation, really. And this corporation has long wanted to take over this planet, ideologically have control of this planet. In other words, hostile takeover and incorporate this planet into their corporation. So they have more planets, more expanse, more strategic area, and more resources, etc. And they have worked on this blueprint for a long time. And they've gone over and over and over and over. They've run simulations on it many times, computer simulations. To see how it turns out. We know right now that we run computer simulations for all sorts of stuff, like the climate, for instance. And well, they run computer simulations on hostile takeovers of planets, actually. And so they've been running some of their ultra supercomputers, which they certainly have, simulating the the takeover of this planet, hostile takeover of this planet, and this has come up with a blueprint of this is the best way to do it. They've have this, by testing it out, they've been able to come up with this blueprint of which way is going to really work the best. And so they're following this blueprint. This is what's actually taking place, and you're never going to hear that out in the world, in the mainstream and the side stream and this stream and that stream media. And they never get around to that. They're being less than forthright. So, at least I remember St. Paul saying, hey, we don't struggle with the problems of powers and kings of potentates of this world. We're really struggling with powers and principalities in the high places of the heavens, meaning space. He was talking about extraterrestrials. He's talking about cosmic corporate culture, which is multidimensional, and that's what we're struggling with here. That's what we're trying to prevent, the hostile takeover of this planet. And we've been resisting it for thousands of years here. But now it's a do or die sort of thing, takeover of this world, and it's full bore, full blast, and we're not resisting it, haven't been resisting it well at this time, because they have this blueprint which has been shown, their computers show them that this will work for them. So when we have all these events taking place in the world, and we have events taking place right now in the United States, for instance, and these continually keep taking place, and you see a pattern. You see a pattern. And if you've been around the block enough times, you start recognizing, say, hey, this seems like a blueprint, like a script that society, culture is following, as if it was scripted. And they say, no, that's not possible. These are all isolated incidents, and nothing is scripted here. You know, and so when you look at it that way, you're continually scratching your head and whining and complaining and getting so upset, but you have no real solutions at all. You don't really bring wisdom into it. So what we say here is it is absolutely scripted. And of course, how this is possible is something you have to understand, how the cosmic corporate culture works, and how clever they are, how ingenious, inventive, clever the technology that they use, and their psychic abilities, and their multidimensional abilities, and all of this. And yet they absolutely know how to script this. They have their operatives in this world who are basically brainwashed, who just basically are easily do what they're told to do psychically. You can, on the psychic level, the script is running in a subtle way within the mind, the one mind, and people who have been trained to respond to the orders that they get, so to speak, of this is how you're supposed to act, this is what you're supposed to do, these are the things that are supposed to happen, and then people go along with the script. Here it's not like we're forced to go along with it, we have free will, but people choose to go along with it. And this is what I've been clarifying in these videos, is why do we go along with this? Why does anyone go along with this script? Because we believe that trying to make lies true, we believe our salvation comes from making lies true. Okay, and we feel it's much easier to do that than to repent and recognize that all this is sheer arrogance. It seems like that's a long, long path, difficult path, where it seems like making lies true, we're almost there. I mean, really, we have this Orwellian sort of situation in the world right now, where lies are being touted as true here, and people, many, many people now are accepting that lies are true. So it doesn't make them true, but it just shows you that the belief that we're getting close, people can feel that and say, hey, wow, because many of us are, many of the world are going along with it. So that seems to be the easy way, the quick way. It's an easy sell to people. It's an easy sell. And of course, those who are easily sold on lies due to their arrogance have gone along with this and are following the script. They're following the script. And I know for the rest of us, we're looking at this and says, everything's upside down and backwards. It's all Machiavellian. Incredibly Machiavellian what's going on at all levels, right? Now, the United States was founded by people who wanted to get away from the script. They felt the encroachment of the script, and they said, we want religious freedom. We want freedom from the script. We want to be free. We don't want the script to be telling us, we want, being pressuring us, severely pressuring us, telling us what to do. We want this land where we can move if the pressure gets too bad. They don't like, it was founded by those who don't like a strong federal government and federal bureaucracy, because that easily is turned into pressuring the population to follow this blueprint of cosmic corporate culture. So what they wanted is religious freedom and freedom. Don't tell us, local governance, don't tell us what to do. We'll decide based on our own contemplation, our own prayer, asking the Holy Spirit. We'll decide what script we want to follow. Okay, they don't want the pressure. So the whole system of the United States of America was set up to make sure that we could minimize the strength of the federal government. That's the whole point of it. That's the whole point of it. And of course, the cosmic corporate culture are absolutely opposed to that. They want to strengthen the federal government as much as possible in this, the takeover of now what's happening in this, in the United States of America now, is been their goal all along of this script, which is to federalize all police forces throughout the country. This is one of their holy grails, and they're in high speed pursuit of this. But keep in mind, all this is scripted, okay? At the level of these supercomputers of cosmic culture, corporate culture, cosmic corporate culture. They do have these multidimensional computational artificial intelligence, which does script and say, this is what you must do, this much. And of course, they believe the results of these computers. They follow along with that. And if it doesn't go according to these computers, then what do they blame? They blame us, like we're crazy. Because the computer told us that it's going to succeed, and you're interfering with that, and so you must be insane. You know, you don't understand that you can't win. You know, in other words, that's their belief. So they think that we're fighting against an inevitable outcome, which to them is insanity. Well, that would be insanity, isn't it, to fight against an inevitable outcome? But the inevitable outcome is that we're going to set down our arrogance and realize that we can't change the will of God. We can't change God. We can't change reality at all. That's the inevitable outcome of all this. And that is what we, those who accept the mood of repentance, that is what we're going towards. So we are the ones who are accepting an inevitable outcome, not fighting against it. And it's cosmic corporate culture that is fighting against inevitable outcomes. So they're the ones that are insane. And they're the ones who, of course, when you're insane and you program a computer, you're going to get insane results, for sure. And so, now, so this is what's going on. Is scripted. Don't react at the level they want you to react to this. Don't address it at the level. All these talking heads on the TV and radio, etc. What they're really doing is they're telling you this is the level where you have to address this situation. Whether it be the talking heads of the progressives or the talking heads of the conservatives. They're both saying this is where you need, this is the level, this is where your attention needs to be to address the situation. And we say, hey, whoa, wait a minute. You're not going to tell us how to address the situation. Well, we're going to ask the Holy Spirit, you know, how to address this, at what level, where our attention needs to be about this. You're not going to tell us how to react to this. We have our own sources of advice on this, okay? That's why it's very dangerous to watch the TV or listen to the radio or the newspapers or magazines, or because all of them are really insisting of this is how you have to view it, you know, at this level. You can have wiggle room at this level, you can maybe this way or that way, but it's still at this very low level, which completely leaves out, omits the role of cosmic corporate culture in this entire situation and their supercomputers, and how they believe that they already know what our future is going to be. The computer has told them what it is, and that to resist this is futile and a sign of insanity. What their supercomputers don't understand at all is repentance. That does not compute at all. And so their software is very buggy, to say the least. And so their results are very buggy. And they basically tell you, you cannot do anything that hasn't already been scripted out, because this is reality, that they feel that they, by scripting the future out, they're creating reality, as it were. So this is what's really going on. And so our response to what's going on needs to be at the right level, right focus here. And that's what we don't have in the information society that is taking place here, which is why I'm getting this information out, among other information, is how do we respond to this? How do we respond to it? Certainly we keep our humor. Certainly we don't get overwrought about it. Certainly we don't respond the way that people tell us to respond. Now, here's a perfect example. I'm going to give you this amazing example that happened today. I'm driving along and I need to make a left-hand turn onto a freeway on-ramp. And so there was two lanes that to make a left-hand turn. And on the right side of this road, there was a green light. I saw that. And so there's a driver to the left of me, and we're in these two lanes, almost side by side. They're a little bit, actually, let me think. No, I was actually behind them. Okay, that's right. I was behind them in the turn lane. And because I noticed the license plate that they had. And they said, it says, impatience is my virtue. Impatience is my virtue. And I said, wow, I saw that. I said, oh, I shook my head. I said, holy cow, that's not a virtue. You know, what is wrong with this person to have a license plate holder that says impatience is my virtue? And so they come up to this turn on the freeway, and something that they turn on the freeway, across two lanes of traffic, and there wasn't any traffic at that time, not much. There was some coming towards us. And I said, something isn't right. I said, somehow my consciousness had the impatience of virtue. I said, something's not right with this driver. I don't know what it is. And then I looked up and I saw across the street by the freeway on-ramp, there was a traffic signal there, and it had an arrow pointing towards the on-ramp, and it was red. Now, this is, admittedly, this is a very bad signage that they have there, signaling. Incredibly bad. Because there's nothing in the middle of the road. It's very wide, six lanes at that point, something like that. There's nothing there at all. It's just way over on the left. So it is easy to miss it. Okay. But it is indeed there. And I said, wait a minute, what is that for? And I hesitated, and then suddenly I said, no. I think it means you cannot turn left. So the car in front of me just went right through, turning left, right through this red light, and right in front of this oncoming traffic. I mean, they made it through, but they just totally ran a red light in a very severe way. And again, impatience is my virtue. I guess that means running red lights. And I slammed on the brakes, and I stopped, and everyone stopped behind me, and I said, whew, wow, I almost messed up. I really almost messed up. Because why? Follow the leader. Follow the leader, okay? So when you get bad leaders, it's a very bad situation, because we have a tendency to follow the leader. And in this case, I said, well, if they're turning, it must be okay. And I almost just followed them just simply because they were doing it, so I should follow along and do what they're doing. But I didn't do it. I stopped. So this indicates something really important. Is the consciousness is there for us to stop following these impatient, bogus leaders, these squatters, essentially, who are squatting in these so-called positions of leadership, but they're going against the light entirely. They're going against the light entirely. So why should we follow them? Of course not, we don't follow them. And it's ludicrous for them to arrogantly ludicrous for them to assert and demand and try to put us on a guilt trip on us that we don't follow their lead. Their lead is against the darkness. Their lead is towards trying to make lies true. Their lead is insane. They're attempting an insane path that can never work. So what they're really doing is they're leading us into extreme delay. Spiritual darkness really means extreme delay. That's the only darkness there is extreme delay. in the world there is this problem, thinking that somehow we need to defeat these people, that defeating the delay is the only way that we get saved. And this is not so. In fact, this is the main way that we get deceived. How does delay manage to delay us? By trying to pull us into arguments and conflict with it, right? That delays us. Let's say you want to get out of jail. Let's say you're in jail, you want to get out of jail, but you're the jailer, and there's this inmate that you have to keep behind bars. Well, as long as you're trying to keep them behind bars, you're still going to be in the jail as well. And that's their whole purpose for being behind the bars, is to keep you there too, keep you in the role of jailer. So as long as we're fighting against the darkness and try to defeat it, we are not turning our attention to what is salvation, actually, that it's here right now for us. So this is the whole scheme that we get tricked on, the battle of good and bad, light and dark, that sort of battle. To engage in that battle is to be severely delayed, because the fact is, our salvation is always here right now. The only way we can be delayed is to be working at something else, and if we want to salvation, we'll be working at something else that we think is necessary or will bring us to salvation, closer to it. But keep in mind, with God, which is omnipresent, there is no closer or farther away. We can't be brought closer, but we can believe in this and struggle with the darkness, thinking that this is necessary. It's a trick. Now, when you stop being fooled by that trick, then those who are trying to get you to struggle, you know, they don't have the power anymore to hook you into delay. You remain enlightened. You continue to abide in reality, the non-dual singular reality of perfection. And people are frantically running and say, where are you going? And they say, there's this great opportunity where the light is going to finally overcome the darkness and all this. Well, everything is already present, perfectly present, absolutely non-fixated in pure spaciousness already. There's nothing that has to be defeated for this to be so. Even these blind leaders trying to make lies true, they also are abiding in pure spaciousness in a totally unfixed way. Though there's nothing that needs to be fixed, actually. Nothing needs to be overcome, nothing that needs to be defeated at all. And paradoxically, when you realize that, this disempowers the whole scam of delay. It doesn't become worse. It gets greatly reduced by doing nothing. Nothing about it whatsoever. You know, people want to get you to react. This is why they do all the stuff they're doing, is to get you to be reacting. This is part of the script. The cosmic corporate culture script. This is a very clever script. They've worked on the psychology here and all of the, you know, reactivity and all of the subtle tricks that the mind plays on itself. Those have been looked at and part of the blueprint, how to manipulate all of that. So again, they want us to go at it at their level. They're saying, hey, here we are, you know, darkness, you know, trying to make lies true, trying to control your lives, trying to, you know, defeat you and overwhelm you. And they want us to react to that in a certain way. Whereas we should be just completely indifferent to it. Say, everything's perfect. What are you talking about? Everything's perfect. That's the one thing they don't want to hear. Everything is one perfect harmony here. It's absolute perfect harmony, actually. And it is. Everything that's happening is a dance of cooperation and harmony. Nothing more than that. So it's just really a paradise of perfect harmony here. And that's the one thing they don't want to hear. The arrogant ones, they don't want to hear that. They say, no. It's just, you're being attacked. You know, you're vulnerable. Bad stuff is happening. Well, it's really just a symphony of perfect harmony taking place. But this isn't seen at the level where they tell you to perceive it, to look at it. You won't see that. So as long as you follow the advice of the ones who are commenting on all this, you're not going to see the truth of the situation. And this will make you feel like you need to do something about it in order to be saved. Another very hot day here. So let's just stick with this for a while. It's irritating to hear this, but we're closing in on what we need to close in on, so to speak. There's no doubt about it. So this is patience. This is our patience. Now, we talked about this car who says, my virtue, impatience is my virtue. Just completely running a red light. That just shows their character, isn't it? So going against the light, we have a world now where much of the leadership of the world is these very impatient, going against the light, trying to make lies true. Because that seems to be the fast, quick, easy way. Because we think they're already true, and it's just a matter of time before God has to accept this too. And when we make lies true, we feel then that this means that our claiming that reality was imperfect, then we could become greater than reality. This would make that this seem true instead of arrogant. So we've gone so far down that road, we think we must be almost there. But then when we try to finish it off, we find out we go into this dead end, very much of a dead end. So, don't react at the level they want you to react at, okay? Keep your focus on this high, non-dual clarification. This is what we have to look at to really resolve the situation. It has partly to do with what I call conceptual chaos, in that when we talk about going beyond concepts, we try to conceptualize that. And the only way we conceptualize being concept-free is through conceptual chaos. And I have experienced this. It was a turning point in my life. And I said, I cannot dwell within this conceptual chaos. There's no way I can abide within that. And then I said, I got to go in some direction then. And this was really the start of the path. This is a real bugaboo that bugs us, and so this is like, we looking at this is how we react to what's going on in the world. We say, wait a minute, I want to have peace of mind. I want to see this perfect harmony that's actually present. I want to recognize, see that there's nothing wrong with reality at all. And so in order to do this, I need to look at this very fundamentally important area. And that's what we do with these videos. So just imagine, it's very, very easy to look at this, is conceptuality actually arises from the belief that we made a deal with God, and that there's two sides that we have to account for. And so our intelligence is what we think is intelligent, is our managing of this deal that we think we've made with God. And conceptuality arises from the say, well, we got this side and we got this side to it. You know, there's two sides to reality, so to speak, now. And it's this deal that we need to somehow keep in equilibrium. It's a dynamic deal, but we need to manage to make sure the deal holds. Now, if we were to recognize that there isn't any deal at all, there's never been any deal, then there's no two sides to reality at all. There's no sides at all. If there's not two sides, there's no sides, really, right? How could there be just one side to anything? If there's not two sides, there's no sides. It's perfection doesn't have any sides to it. That would mean there's no conceptuality. There's no deal to talk about, to think about, to manage at all. Reality doesn't need conceptuality. Not at all. Not in the slightest bit. So we're thinking, I need to be enlightened. I need to be enlightened. But we're thinking that from the conceptual standpoint. And then we say, okay, we need to go beyond concepts, beyond concepts. So they say, well, how do we do that? How do we do that? And so what we do is we try and get rid of concepts, as it were, by simply turning our thinking, our concepts, into absolute chaos, where we cannot follow any thought pattern, thought stream, conceptual explanation, or any of that at all, because everything is just randomly, chaotically moving about. And then we think, oh, okay, that's how we go beyond concepts. Now, this is our mistake, because we're trying to conceptualize being without concepts. So when we really, really try to make a push for freedom, which I did back in 1978, I experienced this conceptual chaos, and I said, what in the world is this? And then I realized I'd have to clarify all of this in order to really get free. So what we do when we're not clear about this, and it's very frightening, is we make sure that whatever remedy we're looking at can be conceptualized. So there's a lot of so-called remedies that really are just there to make sure that we can conceptualize it, that there's two sides to it, in other words. But reality doesn't have that two sides to it at all. So this is how we respond to what's going on in the world, by taking a look at something like this. Now, I haven't quite got past it yet. I'm getting my nerve better and better and better, because when I first experienced it in 1978, it was an absolute shocker, and it left an indelible imprint upon me. I never forgot this experience I had. It was so intense. And I also saw freedom. I also saw enlightenment there. But I saw this massive conceptual chaos there. And I said, you know, wow. Well, what do I do? You know, I don't quite feel I can leap into reality, you know, where there's no conceptualization. How do I conceptualize that leap, you know? And then it's this chaos, and I said, well, I can't make that leap. So what we ultimately have to realize is there isn't any leap at all. There's nothing that can be spoken of conceptually at all. We're already, everything is already just as it is, exactly as it is mere appearance in pure spaciousness. I have an acquaintance who regularly goes trekking in the Himalayas out of Kathmandu, Nepal. And they were just there several months ago in October, last October. And they didn't go this spring season. That's a good decision, wasn't it? It's a good decision not to go there. I was living right, you know. Ultimately, everything that we do is our decision in this world. Now, we can certainly be lobbied by others to decide in a certain way, but ultimately the power of decision rests with us, 100%. Not 99%, 100%. So everything, just as it is right now, without doing anything at all, or no matter what is happening, it's not changing the fact of this non-fixated abidance in pure spaciousness by mere appearance. It is always the same. It is always the same. It is always the same. This fact is always the same. Now, when we can just sit, we can just sit here and not ask that anything happen or not happen from the standpoint of being. When we can do that, then we're enlightened. Suffering from fatigue, end of a long work week, but also this sort of talk. We think we're supposed to be tired, supposed to tire us out. We think it's super difficult. And we've convinced ourselves of this. So as we try to approach this, we tend to get exhausted and very stressed out, even though there's no real intrinsic stress to it at all. But this, the very fact of recognizing this conceptual chaos and then just sitting right here as if it were right there for in front of us, we don't have to react to it at all, we don't have to relate to it at all, this is stressful. It's like we want a concept of no deal. But why does no deal need a concept? It doesn't have any opposite to it. Reality doesn't have any opposite to it. Why do we need concepts? so you tend to lose consciousness here. That's an example. Just like, wow, consciousness tends to fade out as we get right to this point. Okay, so just be aware of that. Usually I'm able to avoid that. Now what we realize is that we don't need to make any leap at all. We don't need to conceptualize reality. There isn't anywhere to go from this conceptual standpoint. Because wherever we go, we're always right here in perfection. There's not a destination that you can, or anywhere you can go, which puts you any closer or further away to reality at all. Nothing you can do that changes your relationship with reality. Nothing whatsoever. So there's no play of conceptuality taking place. So the taboo to looking at this is so strong that it hits you like a narcotic, that where you can't keep your consciousness going. Free disk space. I have enough free disk space. Okay. Wow. It's very strong. So people are reacting in the world to, ain't it awful, and yelling at each other, I hate this kind of, and here we are trying to keep our consciousness, keep our awareness here, as if we have this ball of confusion in front of us, of our attempt to, you know, make conceptuality completely chaotic, as if this were the leap we need to take, or this is reality that we need to leap into. So we're not leaping into it. You see, this is the key. Now, before, I leapt into it back in 1978 because it just seemed like this is the easy, direct, easy path to take, because I'm so used to conceptuality. But now, it's like, no, I don't have to leap into that. Now, once we can become very convinced that we don't need to leap into that, that is not reality, then we can start paying attention to where we really are without the need to do anything about where we are. Just pay attention. Okay, where am I? I don't have to leap into that at all. So what do I do? Where am I? Well, I don't even have to move. Okay, well, where am I? Where am I? Well, we can look at that. You see, non-fixated, abiding in non-fixated spaciousness. I'm non-fixatedly abiding with no inside or outside in the one pure spaciousness that all is also abiding without any inside or outside either. And so from that, all is mere, very transparent appearance, as it were. We see the appearance nature of everything that's empty of fixationness. It's empty of inside-outsideness. Appearance emptiness is how the Dzogchen teachers can say it. Appearance emptiness. It's the appearance that is, we see the emptiness and the appearance, meaning no inside, there's no inside, no outside. Is it empty or is it full? So you might say empty fullness. Appearance, emptiness, or empty fullness. Well, it's everything's full of pure spaciousness, But there's no inside or outside. So is it full or is it empty? It's really neither, actually, or both, you want to say. But you could say neither. Because pure spaciousness is all pervasive. So how can you say something's full of it or empty of it? Full of it implies that it's reached some point where it's full, you know, and it could be less full, and there's some inside-outsideness to it. So concepts really fail to give a clear indication of it. You know, we get, and then again, we fall into the trap of saying, well, if concepts fail to give a clear indication of it, if we just have completely chaotic concepts, this will give a clear indication of what it is. As if this is the final step of conceptual chaos, clarifying reality for us. Well, it's not this. But you see, chaos is all, it's chaotic because we're getting glimpses of all sorts of different positions, possible things, but they're fleeting, they're moving chaotically. And that doesn't give us a clear clarity about reality. Reality is not that way at all. What we want to see it conceptually, so we can say, well, what is my deal? What is my part in the deal of reality? The reality is not a deal. It's not a deal with something. So we don't have any role in terms of managing a deal in reality. And again, we are reacting to what's going on in the world in the way of our choosing here. By our putting our focus here. Now, I prayed for any bodhisattva to come help us right now. It doesn't matter who it is. I don't care. As long as they have healed perception. Bodhisattva means healed perception. So anyone with healed perception, anyone who's willing to function within healed perception to help us out, help us out right now. So I got to somewhere, and there's this roly-poly person who suddenly appeared around my vehicle walking, and they had some broom, and they're smiling, saying, you need this? And I looked at them, kind of smiled, and they had this sort of beatific look about them. You know, just a really very unusual-looking person. And what's the broom signify? I don't know. But I came across a broom recently in a place of business that I've never seen before. And I was using it and saying, wow, it's an amazing broom. What is this? And I asked someone, I said, where'd you get this broom? They said, oh, you know what? There's a train here and it fell off the train. And he said, well, no one's ever seen a broom like this. Anyway, we have no idea where you get a broom like this. But somehow it's part of the train industry that they have this type of broom. The bristles were like really industrially strong, like they could last forever. And the whole binding of it was all in metal, you know, and the handle was all like really strong metal. No, wait a minute. No. The handle was actually wood. That's right. It was very, very thick, heavy-duty wood with some kind of pry bar at the end of the wood handle. And it's just like, I guess it's indigenous to the railway freight industry, this broom. So it's funny that I was using this broom, and I said, wow, this broom can get rid of anything. This can sweep up anything. And then there's this guy with this unusual broom at where he was, another place, saying, he's yelling to somebody, do you want this broom? And I looked at him and I said, huh, interesting. What is a broom? A broom sweeps up, a real good broom sweeps up everything, doesn't it? It can sweep up the toughest stuff. It doesn't break, fall apart. Maybe it's time for us to be swept up. Maybe it's time for us to be swept up. And we say, what kind of broom can sweep us up? Well, that broom that I was using was using on hard asphalt, a really coarse asphalt, you know, rocky, the toughest kind of surface, and it could dig into everything. It could sweep up anything. It's amazing. So I guess that's a symbol of there's, you know, we can get swept up somehow. So we can sit here and realize that we don't need a way to where we are. We're already here. Everything is already perfectly non-fixated, absolutely non-fixated. We don't need a way to dissolve any fixation. Nothing is fixated within pure spaciousness. It doesn't have a grab a hold of it. It's not screwed into it. It's not nailed into it. It doesn't need to be, because there's nowhere else to be. It can never leave it. So there's no reason to try to fixate anything. Everything is already 100% in pure spaciousness, without any possibility of being otherwise. So it's utterly ludicrous to think, well, I need to fixate myself in order to have an identity. And it comes, as always, we bring all this up to get familiar with it. We're not, that's our primary purpose. Conclusions are secondary, actually. We're not trying to struggle to nail down a conclusion. We're just looking at it and getting more and more familiar with that. And at some point, the right look will happen for us, which is we'll just settle into it. We'll just say, okay, this is where it's at. And accept it. There's just an acceptance that arrives. You know, we just decide, okay, I'm just going to accept reality as it is. But this comes once we've gained a certain amount of familiarity with this looking at it. And being patient. Patience is my virtue. We don't follow the leaders leading us against the light of truth. We stop. We don't go that direction. So familiarity has a different feel to it in terms of what we're doing. You know, it's sort of, we're just sort of ambling along here, realizing that the speed that we go at is not so important as the allowing the familiarity to sink in. And the more we do this, the less fatigued we'll get by doing it. We'll say, oh, this is easy. Yeah, just sitting here looking at this, oh, that's easy. Don't even feel bothered by it at all. And then we'll have the energy, the focus to look at it more intensely, right? Look at it even more clearly. This is how it goes. So right now we've gone a little further here, and suffered the suffered some backlash, blowback from it, really, which is fine. That's what you expect. That's expected. Now it's hard to look any further at this point, because the fatigue is there, and it's like, wow, sort of this taboo barrier to look much deeper at this moment. The wow factor is in play. Wow factor is in play. So the conceptual chaos is not reality. It's not a step into reality, nor is the conceptual non-chaos a reality or a step into reality. There aren't any concepts to describe reality. It's indefinable. Again, the fatigue hits very strong. Or you could have overreaction, where you get super energized, but overhyped, and you cannot focus in. That's another defense against it. That's why you have in the Zendo, you have someone who's got the stick, and their job is to anyone who falls asleep to hit, tap them with the stick, whack them with the stick, wake up. It's not a mean thing. It's a helpful thing. Helpful, absolutely. In meditation, where there's many people meditating, and they have their alcoves, they're each meditating in their alcoves. There's someone just who makes the rounds and looks to see if someone slumping over, and whack, wakes them up. Very practical. Because it's been seen throughout history that when you try to look at this, you get this sleepiness that intervenes. And of course people try to defeat this through stimulants. And this is a big mistake. Because as I've said many times, you lose the sensitivity and the patience, which is very important. You have to overcome this sleepiness through clarity and will, not through artificial stimulation. You have to recognize the wow of it and stop in the wow of it and hold yourself there. So keep yourself right there, full stop in the wow. Feel the opposition, feel the defensiveness. Get used to it, see what it is. Work to keep going in spite of it. And whatever progress you make is going to be genuine and not just the result of you're all hyped up on some stimulant, which then later on you'll forget. You'll say, well, how did I do that? I don't remember, I don't know. Oh, I was on some stimulant. Okay, that's what I need to do. And it creates a vicious circle. Speaking of that, of stimulants and drugs, we can take a little look at music. I call music the drug that leads to all other drugs, actually. Music is really a drug. And it leads to other drugs. Why? Because the drug of music is so we like it. We're so like it so much. And especially if you're playing music, the drug of playing music is really intoxicating. But after a while, you start getting used to it, and it loses the intoxication factor, and you're desperate to get it back, and so you will try anything. And ultimately what you end up trying is you're trying various stimulants, various drugs, which then seem to give you this burst of energy that you can, you know, create channel into creativity. And you, and then again the drug like quality of the music kicks in. So, and then it wears off again. So when you really get hooked on the drug of music, you usually find yourself going into drugs, other drugs, whatever. There are many, many drugs you can go into in order to keep the drug of music alive, so to speak. So it can be a very dangerous road to go down. And I have extreme experience with this road. It's amazing. You get obsessed with music, playing music if you're a player. It's amazing how one day, for some reason, you'll just have it. And it's intoxicating, like a drug. Next day, you just don't have it. And there's no intoxicating effect. And then you get obsessed with trying to figure out, well, how can I have it all the time or more often? And you know, I tried to figure it out. I realized if I practiced too much, I'd lose it. And if I didn't practice enough, it wouldn't last long enough. And so you're trying to juggle. Well, how often do I practice, for how long? You know, and it just becomes this obsession to try and figure it out. And yet you never really figure it out. I found that if I didn't play for a while and came back, somehow it seemed fresh and inspirational and strong. I wasn't in any ruts, you know. Whereas if you like play a lot and practice a lot and keep going, you end up getting into ruts and start getting in your own way. So really the thing about music is you're staying out of your own way. And so I found that if I didn't play that often, I could stay out of my own way better. But I also couldn't play as long. I got tired. And so that was a problem too. So I said, well, how can I play all the time and it always seem fresh? And you can never reach that. You can never reach that. And everyone who's a musician knows what I'm talking about. And so it's very frustrating. And you really feel unfulfilled, like I haven't quite reached my potential yet. And so you become a very, very vulnerable target for drugs. And another severe drug is called the muse. The muse is oftentimes you end up searching for a muse, which is someone whose purpose is to stimulate your inspiration, trigger your inspiration, creativity. And musicians, like for instance, male musicians can oftentimes become extraordinarily dependent on like a female muse, whose work is to try and, you know, keep you creative, but that you actually end up becoming dependent on them like a drug, very much like a drug. And then you basically become like a slave to the muse, and the muse can control you, very easily control you. And you'll say like, wow, I just don't feel that creative. Where's the inspiration? What happened? And then the muse will say, well, you might say, well, how come you're not inspiring? The muse will say, no, I am. You're just resisting it, you know. You need to do this. You need to do this. And you say, okay, I'll do anything you tell me to. You become dependent. You become enslaved by the muse. There's no question about it. No question about it. So if you're looking, if you're a creative artist and you're looking for inspiration, you're in trouble. You're in big trouble, actually. I recommend this type of inquiry, satsang inquiry, practice that we're doing, way above any sort of artistic endeavor, way above it. It's infinitely more safe and effective, and doesn't lead to drugs and enslavement. It liberates. And having been through the whole artistic thing for so long, and tasting the bitterness of it to the ultimate dregs, over and over and over and over and over, I know exactly what I'm talking about. I'm going to talk with absolute assurance on this to all artistic people for sure. The artist is desperate. And whether they know it or not, they're searching for a muse, whether it be a person or a drug. They absolutely are. Subconsciously, they're on the lookout. They're on the lookout. I know that. You drive down the street. You're looking for a muse. You're looking for some inspiration. Looking what, you know, I got to find it. I got to find it. It's like a drug addict in search of the drug. The artist has to find the inspiration. Because they feel, you know, this is, without it, life is just without hope. Never going to, you know, just hopeless. Whereas inspiration feels like you're getting closer. You know, I can feel it. I can touch. I can almost touch. I can smell it. I can hear it. Like that. And when it's not there, it's just like you live in flatland. You just live in flatland. So you have to be very careful, like, that you're not using these videos as a muse, as an artistic muse. Absolutely. Try to inspire you artistically. What you have to use them for is the purpose of familiarity and practice, inspiration to practice, and familiarity with truth. Just look at it that way. Look at it. So I'm not trying to be artistically inspired at all by this. So this is the big difference in on the path between those who succeed and don't. If you're looking at the spiritual path as a way to as a means to artistic inspiration, you're going to fail, and you're going to get hooked up with some nasty muse who's going to really severely put you through the ringer. It's all your fault, you know, and you just have to serve them better, worship them better, do what they say better, obey what they tell you better, and I know. I did know one of the greatest artists in the world, actually. One of the most famous and successful artists in the entire planet. And I know what happened with him. He got hooked up with a very bad muse. Ended up killing him. No doubt about it. Under very suspicious circumstances, actually. I should have warned him. I wasn't quite clear enough, you know, I realized something was wrong, but he was desperate for the muse, and someone saw that and exploited it and said, there are many professional muses around, actually, who are looking for that tortured artist, the one who's looking, and they know exactly how to exploit it. And how to get everything they can possibly get out of it, in terms of financial security. And I mean, the artist, the desperate artist, will give up everything to the muse. Their bank account, their house, their future, everything. And then once the muse has it all, the muse has ways to get the artist to do themselves in, maybe with a little help from the muse, you see. Absolutely. That happens a lot, more than we realize. And this situation with my acquaintance absolutely did happen. Very dangerous situation, actually. That's the way that fails. Okay, that's the path. So there's many who take the spiritual path, but they're looking for artistic inspiration. That is going to fail. That's the path of failure. You have to take the spiritual path because you truly want to be liberated from suffering, from death, from confusion, from fear, And you truly love truth. You love truth. Take it past because you love truth. You want to be true to yourself. You want to drop the arrogance. You want to experience the oneness, the beingness. That has to be the motivation and the goal. Not so that you can become some great artist or you know, play music that tends to, you know, inspire you, make you feel some certain way. That's a drug. Reality is not a drug. Music is a drug. All music is a drug, actually. Take it from the horse's mouth. Having been there and done that, all music is a drug. That's not the goal. That's not the goal. But many people think that you know, that's like, well, that's a substitute goal that we use just to keep us going until we finally make lies true. We need to drug ourselves because we're so dissatisfied with this whole path of trying to make lies true. We need to drug ourselves just to keep on going. And so music is one of the main ways we drug ourselves. And then we throw that into, you know, movies, and you know, musical productions and theater and entertainment of all sorts, where you have the costumes, the singing, the dancing, the music, and the plot, like an opera, you know, kind of. We try to throw everything, the whole kitchen sink, you know, everything, including the kitchen sink, into drugging ourselves in a certain way so that we'll just keep on waiting. We think that if we wait long enough, we'll get familiar enough with the quote-unquote solution, which is we think there has to be a way to make lies true. It's just that we're not accepting it because we're not familiar enough with it. Once we get familiar enough with it, then magically it will suddenly work for us. So as we wait for this, wait, we have to keep ourselves distracted from our dissatisfaction, because our dissatisfaction is saying, hey, you know, I want to drop all this arrogance. And we say, no, that's too difficult. We've come too far for that now. Can't do that. How are we doing here? Well, okay. It hasn't been easy. It hasn't been easy at all here. And I never expect it to be easy. You know, I expect it to be tough. And if it isn't so bad, you'll be pleasantly surprised. But when you do your spiritual practice, just expect it's going to be tough. Now, I used to spend my time practicing musical instruments. 2 hours at a time was nothing. You know, 4 hours was not, you know, was no big deal. You know, when you hit 8 hours, you practice, you'd say, yeah, I put in a good practice. Now, it takes a lot of creativity to practice for 8 hours. That is true, right? Yeah. So, but that's all stopped all that. Of course, the muse is not happy about that. The muse is still hoping to get everything from me. Well, not that I have anything to give anymore. It's already been dissipated. But the muse is still, whatever I do get, the muse still wants to lay claim to it, saying, I inspired you to that. No, the muse did not inspire me to this. The Holy Spirit inspired me to it. The Bodhisattvas, the Saviors. They're not muses. They're not musical muses. And the muse cannot inspire to enlightenment, actually. They pull you down. They pull you down. You know, they may superficially look beautiful and alluring and intriguing and exotic and all this stuff. And you feel like... But that inspiration is not towards enlightenment. That's towards some sort of drama and theater and you know, drugging yourself, actually. So they cannot lay any sort of claim to be the source of inspiration. Because if they were enlightened, they wouldn't be making any such a claim anyway. And if they're not enlightened, how can they be a true muse of enlightenment? I've never felt any of the spiritual teachers as if they wanted to lay some claim on my enlightenment or, you know, anything like that. Not never felt that way. like they're trying to say, well, I'm the one who's responsible. I'm the one who inspires. So you owe me. You owe me. You have to do what I tell you to do and stuff. And I've never felt that way. But the muse most certainly wants their payment. That's their ticket to salvation, they think. If they can just keep us waiting long enough, then actually, of course, the music that we make is a narcotic for them too. So the muse wants the music. This is often what you'd see in bands and in music scene, is there's the groupies, hanger-ons, muses, there's a whole entourage basically, and they're getting drugged severely by what the music, and they're demanding that you play it. Say, hey, I need the drug, play it. So they it's a symbiotic relationship. They need the musician as much as the musician needs them. It's sort of like a codependency. But the muses tend to be smart enough to have the upper hand and keep the musicians quite insecure. You see this, the stars traveling with an entourage, who are those people? Well, that's the symbiotic relationship that's going on, actually. Now we tolerate, drug use and these lifestyles by artists and musicians because they give us these narcotics, and we're all junkies ourselves. So a junkie is not going to judge the pusher too strongly. They're going to say, hey, whatever you need to do to get me the drugs, that doesn't matter to me. So we tend to say, yeah, whatever you got to do, musicians, it doesn't matter to us. You can be as depraved as you want to be. We don't care. We don't care. Just give us the drugs. Just give us the songs. As that group Traffic, Dear Mr. Fantasy, play us all a tune, something that'll make us all happy. You are the one that, after all these years, play a song, play a tune, make it snappy. This is, talking about the desperation. Hey, play me a song. I want to hear it. I need to be drugged. I need to feel inspired because I'm so tired waiting for what has never happened. And I don't want to hear that it will never happen. Because then I will try to conceptualize never happening. And it'll be chaotic. I'll try to conceptualize reality, and this ends up being this conceptual chaos, which then terrifies us, actually. We think we're going crazy. We think we'll never recover. I mean, when you try to leap into reality by conceptualizing it, you think that you've gone completely insane, and you never will recover, actually. Because your thoughts, what you're used to with your thinking, because concepts now, have completely scrambled into this utter chaos, and there's no pattern you can determine a starting point. We say, okay, well, let me put these concepts here and let me start building my conceptual identity back. You can't see any way to put it back together again at all. So it's an absolutely terrifying experience. So we're trying to avoid that by keeping ourselves drugged. This is what these entertainers are all about. People get this type of high off of it that makes them feel like they can last another day. And sometimes you feel so down, it's uninspired, you want to listen to a song just to pick you up, just to inspire you a little bit. It's very... So the whole situation, the whole scene, the whole artistic scene, is something that you want to stay away from, actually, on the spiritual path. And you certainly don't want to look at anyone who is clarifying as a muse for you, okay? This will leads to big trouble. That's why those on the path should engage in spiritual practice. They should engage in spiritual practice. Like in the Zendo, you know, what are they doing? They're sitting quietly. They're engaging in spiritual practice. Whatever art is present, if any, is minimal and carefully put into some right context where it's not designed to be the muse to you. And, unless it's so, well, it's a tricky thing, but it can be managed, and it's a matter of emphasis and a matter of your own determination of what you really want. Now, a spiritual situation can deteriorate if you get some very clever muse who gets in there and starts subtly talking to everyone, like, say, hey, you know, this work is so difficult. There probably is a quicker way to do it here. Maybe if we just get some inspiration going in the situation, we might, you know, be more inspired and work better, etc. And gradually the muse is able to lead people astray like that. It's a very dangerous situation. That's why there's a lot of rules and regulations in spiritual communities, practicing situations. Those are dedicated to practicing, where the whole artistic scene is squashed. You know, they don't want to let the muse gain a foothold in that situation, because once they start gaining some footholds, it's a very slippery slope. So there's not a bunch of festivals and celebrations and artistic expressions and things like that going on. It's usually very barren, some bleak, barren, disciplined, you know, it's all business. And of course the muse hates that, because they want to be drugged too. You know, they're desperate for their drugs. They're hoping, hey, if we could just only turn this situation towards, you know, the artistic drugs we want, then we'll be happily narcotized, and we can keep waiting for what we think is the very soon advent of lies being made true, and then we don't have to undo all our arrogance, let go of, we don't have to deal with the continuity problem, we don't have to set our arrogance down, we don't have to get familiar with truth, we don't have to do any of that. If we just wait a little longer, this is the trouble. So they try to bring entertainment into the situation. because that's not the right type of inspiration. As we've seen here, it is the battle of spiritual will, unstimulated, to be able to experience clearly the dynamic of defensiveness. This is what really brings familiarity to us and gives us true confidence. Because now I know what I'm really dealing with. So I see better what am I really dealing with. And then this makes wisdom, okay, how do I then flip the script on this? Whereas if you have stimulants, you don't know what you're really dealing with, so how can you flip the script properly? How can you really do spiritual practice? How can you full stop on the wow? You don't. You may just keep being assertive, but you don't full stop in the wow, you don't flip the script, you're not able to deal with real progress. It's more like a showing off. So yeah, fatigue will come sometimes. It hit me so bad in this video. But I say, great, that's good, that's wonderful. I'm aware now, at this depth, you know, I'm aware, I've been able to, okay, so now I know the parameters of, you know, and just there's a basic clarity about it. What's fun about all this is making progress and getting past all these defenses, and that's what's fun, because we know we're getting closer and closer and closer to accepting where we are right now. Which is beyond concepts. Jesus says beyond words. Well, concepts are made up of words, of thoughts. So journey beyond concepts, journey beyond words. And again, it's not beyond, but how else are you going to say it? You know, once you journey beyond words, you realize that the words doesn't describe it. You might say journey into accepting we don't need any journey. The journey beyond journey. So I feel, I feel close. I feel the solidity of now. It's just right close, but it means I'm still in a journey mode, which means a future, right? Which is really waiting mode for something to take place in the future. So we're like trying to place ourselves in the future to get to the result we claim is in the future. And by doing that, we overlook the solidity of the now, the absoluteness of the now. And again, we're just getting familiar with this sort of talk, this sort of looking. We're not trying to impress anyone with, you know, a bingo response necessarily. If it comes, it comes, and full stop in the wow, that's fine. Yeah, if it comes, it comes, let it come. If the acceptance is there, let it be. So we believe that the answers in the future, meaning our familiarity, will eventually magically transform lies into truth. So in order to try to get that salvation we think is there, we're trying to get into the future, because right now we don't have it. So we are presuming that we're in the future somehow by overlooking the present. And the shock we get is the realization that the overlooking of the present has never placed us in the future, that there's no such thing as the future. We've always just actually gone nowhere. So I'd love to have this sort of shock. I mean, this is what I live for. Let's have this shock. I've never gone anywhere. Yes, I already know that I've never gone anywhere. Yes, I already know that I've never gone anywhere. Yes, I already know that I see that I've never gone anywhere. I've never left now. Yes, I already know that I'm seeing that I never left now. Yes, I already know that I'm seeing that I never left now. Oh, yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that I've never left now, that nothing has ever left now. That this tree has never left now, that this hedge, that this wall has never left now, this sidewalk's never left now, that this place has never left now, that tree has never left now, that those leaves have never left now, that this wall has never left now, this window has never left now, that this sky has never left now. Yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that nothing has ever left now. Where else can we put this magical transformation of lies into truth except in the future? It hasn't happened yet. The only way to believe it can happen is to say it's going to happen some point in the future. So we have to believe there's such a thing as a future. We have to believe that the future exists. But actually it doesn't. How can pure spaciousness be said to have a future? It's perfect right now. It's everywhere right now. There's nothing to add or subtract to it. So there's no way that anything can change its relationship to pure spaciousness. The relationship it has now is the relationship it has always had and always will have. So you can experience the completeness of that relationship right now. The fundamental relationship of appearance to being, to pure spaciousness. All of that is perfect now. Whether something is arising, sustaining or subsiding, it's all the same relationship to now. It's an unbroken cycle of relationship in the now. So our whole lives, we've been missing this. We've been missing real experiencing our entire lives. This is the regret that we have to accept. There isn't any quality, future quality of abidance, of appearance and pure spaciousness that is going to deviate one bit from what is the quality that is right now. Now, appearances are always changing, but the relationship of appearance to pure spaciousness never changes. So all events are always being experienced in the now, right now. There's no other place to experience them. Everything's being experienced right now. And the relationship of everything that's taking place with pure spaciousness is exactly the same always. So we certainly don't have to wait. Waiting is a useless strategy, actually. It's not going to change the outcome one bit. Friend of mine's going to Europe next week, and they're very worried, concerned about all the unrest over there. So I guess the unrest, I said, what unrest? What's going on? I don't know what's going on. And they said, well, this and this and this and this. And I said, wow, yes, unrest is everywhere, huh? And yeah, we're talking about the ultimate rest, the ultimate rest, not unrest, but rest. Resting in the now. That's called the everlasting arms. Christianity, leaning on the everlasting arms of now. Call it the arms of God. Call it God. And we can't translate the now into the future, you know, and conceptually put it into a future. And we can't get rid of concepts by having conceptual chaos. That doesn't get rid of concepts, actually. You just have a chaotic conceptuality. So again, your practice is often tough. Expect it to be tough. I knew this would be tough. And there's always a point where you feel like, let me just rest first. Let me just rest first. You know, this seems too tough. And well, if I rest, I get up, I'm all groggy, and then it's time to get dinner, and then maybe there's a baseball game on, you want to just take it easy, and then it's getting late, and then you're getting tired, and you don't, you know, it's just like that. So there's always a point where you'll feel like you have to use your will just a little bit, and it kind of hurts. You feel like a little sting, like, wow, this isn't going to be easy. That's how you feel, like this isn't going to be that easy. And it isn't. That's why having a trainer is helpful, right? Yeah, having discipline, having house rules, is difficult to have the will to do it. So, any house rules, that you're gonna get to help you out is very, it's very good, very welcome. Don't get sidetracked by the muse. Who will say, come on, let's play. I want fun, come on. You're no fun, let's go. You know, try to get you in that drug way. So we're just staying close to this, all this information we've gotten. It's called staying close, full stop in the wow. Is you're just staying close. You're making sure that you don't drift away, okay? What the mind tries to do is it tries to drift away. And as it was hitting me earlier, my mind was just drifting away just until I just into sleep. So full stop in the wow, we stay in touch with, we don't allow ourselves to drift away. We know we're really close, so we don't drift away. Just not drifting away is, you know, a major victory. Very important. Because when we stay close, it's not tough, far away for our attention to then look again. You know, we can look again and it's not so difficult. But if we really drift away, then we lose the thread. Going through an experience of severe fatigue and sleepiness again now, and the mind trying to pull, you know, get pulled down into that. It's very interesting. So don't run for a sleeping pill or don't run for some, you know, caffeine. Just stick with it. Mind wants us to forget that we were ever here. Just to forget, go into oblivion about it. To forget how close we are. Now, the help of a trainer, a spiritual trainer, is as you go into these modes, you know, they can help yell, hey, you know, wake you up, get you out of it. But you can do it yourself too. Something as if this weren't important, you know, as if sleep were more important, you know, than this. This is what it feels trying to convince me of. Just go to sleep and everything will be okay. No, no, it won't. Again, that's looking for a future outcome. It's looking for an outcome. Now is not an outcome. Again, trying to get me. Wow, again. Amazing, amazing, amazing. Going through these layers. It's like turbulence, like a plane flying, going through turbulence. There's this mental turbulence that's just like unawareness. Coming again. So I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And yes, I already know. That I already see that there's no step to take. Yes, I already know that I already see there's nothing I need to do. Yes, I already know that I already see that everything is absolutely non-fixated right now. Everything is non-fixated right now. Everything is non-fixated right now. Absolutely non-fixated. Oh, I just about fell over there. Wow. This comes out of nowhere. Some people try to hide this camouflage. Like, for instance, they'll get drunk, and they're kind of sort of imitating this defensiveness, and they'll say, "No, I don't have defensiveness. I just have a drinking problem. I don't have a defensiveness problem." No, no, no. What's causing this is the drinking. You see how clever we can be. Whereas I know that has nothing to do with any drugs or any drinking. Nada, nothing. This is 100%. You know, the intensity of the defenses right here. It's like as we get closer to the treasure cave, we seem to fall, get very tired and droopy, and we just can't keep going. So there's some force field, you know, like preventing us from getting there. Like, and if we take stimulants, well, what happens is we'll say, "Hey, you know what? I think I feel like kind of like running over there or going over there," and rationalizing. You have the energy to run away, and you're rationalizing it, saying, "You know, like, well, I'm really doing something. I'm really getting somewhere. That's great." Well, retreat is not what we want to say is getting somewhere. So in a spiritual community, practice, it's probably important for everybody to have some role that helps out. You know, some role. You know, even if it's the role of a steady meditator, that's a great role right there. That's the best role, really. I mean, but the role of the stick, you know, wake up, don't go. If they really you'll fall asleep, and then, you know, whack, whereas right now I'm struggling, you know, and so they'd be watching me to see if I'm going to go to sleep or not. Be someone who keeps everything neat and tidy. Might be someone who reminds everybody that, you know, that it's time to practice. Call to practice. There's that role. There's someone that might help everyone cool down, the cool down period. There might be someone who that's their role. There might be, you know, flipping the script roles. So there might be roles that everybody can have some, realize that they're helping out the overall situation. Maybe someone who's auditing them, watching everyone, looking, you know, for excessive acting out, scratching, itching, sneezing, all this kind of stuff, and saying, you know, no, don't do it. You know, keep, you know, remind you, hands to hands, you're sitting quietly. You know, cut down the restlessness. So a cooperative endeavor, a meditation community, a practice community, a spiritual practice community. They certainly do exist. Don't hear much about them, that's for sure. They're not seeking publicity. They don't want muses to come looking for them. Publicity seekers. Just one moment. Okay, and then there's the role of the one who takes care of emergencies, so everybody isn't, you know, the official take care of emergencies person, so the others are not distracted. So I just got a call, and there's an emergency. I have to do some little stupid thing, and if there's someone else, you know, who's on duty to take care of that stuff, then all the other meditators wouldn't be bothered. There'd just be one person to call, and that's it. Unfortunately, here it's just me, so I have to take care of all this stuff. So. How'd we do? Almost 2 hours. Very great. Okay. That's it for this one. I'm going to stop the catcher now. Keep practicing and struggle through it.